Here we're going to look at the Wiggers diagram. And the Wiggers diagram is a very complex figure shown here on the right that lays out the cardiac events that all occur sort of in a particular pattern within each cardiac cycle. But it's hard to delineate, it's hard to describe what's going on within this complex diagram without looking at them essentially one at a time, the individual components. And so we have a deconstructed Wiggers over here on the left. So in A, we're going to look simply at one of these traces. We're going to look at the atrial pressure here in the green line. We're going to use our ECG as our reference for each of these figures that follow A through D. And we do that because the ECG represents the electrical activity of the heart. And once again, the electrical activity is a predictor of the mechanical, which is what we're looking at within many of these traces. Now, the atrial pressure is going to rise when the atrial cardiomyocytes are depolarized. Well, they begin to depolarize at P, right? The P wave is generated by atrial depolarization, but they're fully depolarized during the PR segment. Fully depolarized means contracting. Contracting means generating pressure, and our atrial cells are contracting, driving blood flow into the ventricles. In B, we're going to look at ventricular pressure alone. Right, again, under our ECG trace. Now we find that under our ST segment and a little bit beyond, we're going to be generating our ventricular pressure. If we recall, our ventricular cells depolarize during the QRS complex, but then they remain depolarized during the ST segment. That's when the majority of our ventricular pressure is generated. And in this case, we're pressurizing that blood to drive it out through the semilunar valves into the systemic and pulmonary circuits. Come below that into C, we're looking at ventricular volume now. The ventricular volume trace really does tell us a lot about the cardiac cycle. We can see that during the TP segment up above here, right, when the heart is entirely in diastole, we're passively filling the ventricles through venous return. Then the atria are stimulated to contract at P, and then they contract during the PR segment. That gives us our active filling phase here. Then, the atria repolarize and the ventricles are depolarizing, but we're not really moving any blood at that moment, and so we're isovolumic, right? Isovolumic meaning same volume of the ventricles, and our line is therefore flat. Once the ventricles generate enough pressure to open the semilunar valves, we'll no longer be isovolumic, and we begin to eject blood into those circuits, the pulmonary and systemic circuit, through that open semilunar valve. We eject our stroke volume. Then the ventricle starts to relax. You can see that phase here. As it starts to relax, eventually that semilunar valve will close and we become isovolumic again. Now we don't immediately begin to fill yet because the pressure in the ventricle has to fall below atrial pressure before that AV valve opens. But once it does, we're right back into passive filling. And the ventricles again filling up with their diastolic volume to prepare for that next ejection phase. Finally, down here in D, the whole point of this is to generate arterial blood pressure to drive blood flow through our cardiovascular circuits. Here we can see that our arterial pressure spike occurs during the ejection of blood by the ventricles, right? This is when we're adding volume to the arterial circuit, and that enhanced volume during that ejection boosts blood pressure for a very short period. When we stop ejecting, when we become isovolumic again, that pressure will start to fall all the way down to our diastolic pressure, the lowest pressure in the arterial circuit. Now in E, we just have the summary of all of A through D being stacked up. Right? We've added a little bit more information. We can see where our valves are opening and closing on either side of our isovolumic phases, isovolumic contraction over here, isovolumic relaxation over here, right? When we're gaining pressure on the way up and then losing pressure on the way down. And again, we're isovolumic when both the inflow door and the outflow doors are closed. The inflow door being the AV valves, those are the filling valves, if you will, and the outflow doors being the semilunar valves, the gateways to the aorta and the pulmonary trunk. When both of those are closed, no blood is moving and we're isovolumic. Last but not least, we have our heart sounds down here. The heart sounds are generated by turbulent flow that occurs when the valves close. And our heart sounds 1 and 2 are the dominant lub and dub heart sounds that you're used to hearing. The heart sound 1 would occur first. That's the AV valves closing. as our ventricular pressure starts to rise and drive blood backwards into those atria, closing that valve. And then the heart sound two, the semilunar valves are closing as the ventricles lose pressure and blood would tend to flow backwards into the heart, closing those semilunar valves. Finally, heart sound three is shown. It's not found in all people, but it's found when the AV valves open and blood begins to fill the heart passively, fill the ventricles passively, generating a sound in some individuals with elevated blood volumes.